Section 10 of the Jungle Book. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Rachel. The Jungle Book by Rudyard Kipling. The White Seal, Part 1. Oh, hush thee, my baby, the night is behind us, and black are the waters that sparkled so green. The moon o'er the combers looks downward to find us at rest in the hollows that rustle between. Where billow meets billow, then soft be thy pillow. Ah, weary wee flipperling, curl at thy ease. The storm shall not wake thee, nor shark overtake thee, asleep in the arms of the slow-swinging seas. Seal Lullaby. All these things happened several years ago at a place called Novastoshna, or Northeast Point, on the island of St. Paul, away and away in the Bering Sea. Limmershin, the winter wren, told me the tale when he was blown onto the rigging of a steamer going to Japan, and I took him down into my cabin and warmed and fed him for a couple days, till he was fit to fly back to St. Paul's again. Limmershin is a very quaint little bird, but he knows how to tell the truth. Nobody comes to Novastoshna except on business, and the only people who have regular business there are seals. They come in the summer months by hundreds and hundreds of thousands out of the cold gray sea, for Novastoshna beach has the finest accommodation for seals of any place in the world. Sea Catch knew that, and every spring would swim from whatever place he happened to be in, would swim like a torpedo boat straight for Novastoshna, and spend a month fighting with his companions for a good place on the rocks, as close to the sea as possible. Sea Catch was 15 years old, a huge gray fur seal with almost a mane on his shoulders, and long wicked dog teeth. When he heaved himself up on his front flippers, he stood more than 4 feet clear off the ground, and his weight, if anyone had been bold enough to weigh him, was nearly 700 pounds. He was scarred all over with the marks of savage fights, but he was always ready for just one fight more. He would put his head on one side, as though he were afraid to look his enemy in the face. Then he would shoot it out like lightning, and when the big teeth were firmly fixed on the other seal's neck, the other seal might get away if he could, but Sea Catch would not help him. Yet Sea Catch never chased a beaten seal, for that was against the rules of the beach. He only wanted room by the sea for his nursery. But as there were 40 or 50 thousand other seals hunting for the same thing each spring, the whistling, bellowing, roaring, and blowing on the beach was something frightful. From a little hill called Hutchinson's Hill you could look over 3.5 miles of ground covered with fighting seals, and the surf was dotted all over with the heads of seals hurrying to land and begin their share of the fighting. They fought in the breakers, they fought in the sand, and they fought on the smooth, warm basalt rocks of the nurseries, for they were just as stupid and unaccommodating as men. Their wives never came to the island until late in May or early in June, for they did not care to be torn to pieces, and the young 2, 3, and 4-year-old seals who had not begun housekeeping went inland about 1/2 mile through the ranks of the fighters, and played about on the sand dunes in droves and legions, and rubbed off every single green thing that grew. They were called the Holluschickie, the Bachelors, and there were perhaps 200 or 300 thousand of them at Novastoshna alone. Sea Catch had just finished his 45th fight one spring, when Matka, his soft, sleek, gentle-eyed wife, came up out of the sea, and he caught her by the scruff of her neck and dumped her down at his reservation, saying gruffly, "Late as usual, where have you been?" It was not the fashion for Sea Catch to eat anything during the 4 months he stayed on the beaches, and so his temper was generally bad. Matka knew better than to answer back. She looked round and cooed, "How thoughtful of you! You've taken the old place again."
"I should think I had," said Sea Catch. "Look at me."
He was scratched and bleeding in 20 places. One eye was almost out, and his sides were torn to ribbons. "Oh, you men, you men," Matka said, fanning herself with her hind flipper. "Why can't you be sensible and settle your places quietly? You look as though you had been fighting with the killer whale."
"I haven't been doing anything but fight since the middle of May. The beach is disgracefully crowded this season. I've met at least 100 seals from Lukannon Beach, house-hunting. Why can't people stay where they belong?"
"I've often thought we should be much happier if we hauled out at Otter Island instead of this crowded place," said Matka.
"Bah! Only the Holluschickie go to Otter Island. If we went there, they would say we were afraid. We must preserve appearances, my dear."
Sea Catch sank his head proudly between his fat shoulders and pretended to go to sleep for a few minutes, but all the time he was keeping a sharp lookout for a fight. Now that all the seals and their wives were on the land, you could hear their clamor, miles out to sea above the loudest gales. At the lowest counting, there were over 1,000,000 seals on the beach, old seals, mother seals, tiny babies, and holluschickie, fighting, scuffling, bleeding, crawling, and playing together, going down to the sea and coming up from it in gangs and regiments, lying over every foot of ground as far as the eye could reach, and skirmishing about in brigades through the fog. It is nearly always foggy at Nova Scotia, except when the sun comes out and makes everything look all pearly and rainbow-colored for a little while. Kotick, Matka's baby, was born in the middle of that confusion, and he was all head and shoulders, with pale, watery blue eyes, as tiny seals must be, but there was something about his coat that made his mother look at him very closely.
"Sea Catch," she said at last, "our baby's going to be white."
"Empty clamshells and dry seaweed," snorted Sea Catch. "There never has been such a thing in the world as a white seal."
"I can't help that," said Matka. "There's going to be now," and she sang the low crooning seal song that all the mother seals sing to their babies.
"You mustn't swim till you're 6 weeks old, or your head will be sunk by your heels. And summer gales and killer whales are bad for baby seals. Are bad for baby seals, dear rat, as bad can be. But splash and grow strong and you can't be wrong, child of the open sea."
Of course the little fellow did not understand the words at first. He paddled and scrambled about by his mother's side, and learned to scuffle out of the way when his father was fighting with another seal, and the two rolled and roared up and down the slippery rocks. Matka used to go to sea to get things to eat, and the baby was fed only once in 2 days, but then he ate all he could and throve upon it. The first thing he did was to crawl inland, and there he met tens of thousands of babies of his own age, and they played together like puppies, went to sleep on the clean sand, and played again. The old people in the nurseries took no notice of them, and the holluschickie kept to their own grounds, and the babies had a beautiful playtime. When Matka came back from her deep-sea fishing, she would go straight to their playground and call, as a sheep calls for a lamb, and wait until she heard Kotick bleat. Then she would take the straightest of straight lines in his direction, striking out with her four flippers and knocking the youngsters head over heels right and left. There were always a few hundred mothers hunting for their children through the playgrounds, and the babies were kept lively. But, as Matka told Kotick, "so long as you don't lie in muddy water and get mange, or rub the hard sand into a cut or scratch, and so long as you never go swimming when there is a heavy sea, nothing will hurt you here." Little seals can no more swim than little children, but they are unhappy until they learn. The first time that Kotick went down to the sea, a wave carried him out beyond his depth, and his big head sank and his little hind flippers flew up, exactly as his mother had told him in the song, and if the next wave had not thrown him back again, he would have drowned. After that, he learned to lie in a beach pool and let the wash of the waves just cover him and lift him up, while he paddled, but he always kept his eye open for big waves that might hurt. He was 2 weeks learning to use his flippers, and all that while he floundered in and out of the water, and coughed and grunted, and crawled up the beach and took catnaps on the sand, and went back again, until at last he found that he truly belonged to the water. Then, you can imagine the times that he had with his companions, ducking under the rollers or coming in on top of a comber, and landing with a swash and a splutter as the big wave went whirling far up the beach, or standing up on his tail and scratching his head as the old people did, or playing I'm the King of the Castle on slippery, weedy rocks that just stuck out of the wash. Now and then he would see a thin fin, like a big shark's fin, drifting along close to shore, and he knew that it was the killer whale, the grampus, who eats young seals when he can get them. And Kotick would head for the beach like an arrow, and the fin would jig off slowly, as if it were looking for nothing at all. Late in October the seals began to leave St. Paul's for the deep sea, by families and tribes, and there was no more fighting over the nurseries, and the holluschickie played anywhere they liked. "Next year," said Matka to Kotick, "you will be a holluschickie,
but this year you must learn how to catch fish." They set out together across the Pacific, and Matkah showed Kotick how to sleep on his back, with his flippers tucked down by his side and his little nose just out of the water. No cradle is so comfortable as the long rocking swell of the Pacific. When Kotick felt his skin tingle all over, Matkah told him he was learning the feel of the water, and that tingly, prickly feelings meant bad weather coming, and he must swim hard and get away. "In a little time," she said, "you'll know where to swim to, but just now we'll follow Sea Pig, the porpoise, for he is very wise." A school of porpoises were ducking and tearing through the water, and little Kotick followed them as best he could. "How do you know where to go?" he panted. The leader of the school rolled his white eye and ducked under.
"My tail tingles, youngster," he said. "That means there's a gale behind me. Come along. When you're south of the sticky water," he meant the equator, "and your tail tingles, that means there's a gale in front of you and you must head north. Come along. The water feels bad here."
This was one of the many things that Kotick learned, and he was always learning. Matkah taught him to follow the cod and the halibut along the undersea banks, and wrench the rockling out of his hole among the weeds, how to skirt the wrecks lying 100 fathoms below water, and dart like a rifle bullet in at one porthole and out another as the fishes ran, how to dance on the top of the waves when the lightning was racing all over the sky, and wave his flipper politely to the stumpy-tailed albatross and the man-of-war hawk as they went down the wind, how to jump 3 or 4 feet clear of the water like a dolphin, flippers close to the side and tail curved, to leave the flying fish alone because they were all bony, to take the shoulder-piece out of a cod at full speed 10 fathoms deep, and never to stop and look at a boat or a ship, but particularly a rowboat. At the end of 6 months, what Kotick did not know about deep-sea fishing was not worth the knowing, and all that time he never set flipper on dry ground. One day, however, as he was lying half asleep in the warm water somewhere off the island of Juan Ferdinand's, he felt faint and lazy all over, just as human people do when the spring is in their legs, and he remembered the good firm beaches of Novastoshnya 7,000 miles away, the games his companions played, the smell of the seaweed, the seal roar, and the fighting. That very minute he turned north, swimming steadily, and as he went on, he met scores of his mates, all bound for the same place, and they said, "Greeting, Kotick! This year we are all holluschickie, and we can dance the fire dance in the breakers off Lukannon, and play on the new grass. But where did you get that coat?" Kotick's fur was almost pure white now, and though he felt very proud of it, he only said, "Swim quickly, my bones are aching for the land." And so they all came to the beaches where they had been born, and heard the old seals, their fathers, fighting in the rolling mist. That night Kotick danced the fire dance with the yearling seals. The sea is full of fire on summer nights, all the way down from Novastoshnya to Lukannon, and each seal leaves a wake like burning oil behind him and a flaming flash when he jumps, and the waves break in great phosphorescent streaks and swirls. Then they went inland to the holluschickie grounds and rolled up and down in the new wild wheat and told stories of what they had done while they had been at sea. They talked about the Pacific as boys would talk about a wood that they had been nutting in, and if anyone had understood them, he could have gone away and made such a chart of that ocean as never was. The 3- and 4-year-old holluschickie romped down from Hutchinson's Hill, crying, "Out of the way, youngsters! The sea is deep, and you don't know all that's in it yet. Wait till you've rounded the horn. Hi, you yearling, where did you get that white coat?"
"I didn't get it," said Kotick. "It grew." And just as he was going to roll the speaker over, a couple of black-haired men with flat red faces came from behind a sand dune, and Kotick, who had never seen a man before, coughed and lowered his head. The holluschickie just bundled off a few yards and sat, staring stupidly. The men were no less than Carrick Booterin, the chief of the seal-hunters on the island, and Patalamon, his son. They came from the little village, not half a mile from the sea-nurseries, and they were deciding what seals they would drive up to the killing-pens, for the seals were driven just like sheep, to be churned into sealskin jackets later on.
"Ho!" said Patalamon. "Look, there's a white seal!"
Carrick Booterin turned nearly white under his oil and smoke, for he was an Aleut, and Aleuts are not clean people. Then he began to mutter a prayer.
"Don't touch him, Patalamon. There has never been a white seal since I was born. Perhaps it is old Zaharoff's ghost. He was lost last year in the big gale."
"I'm not going near him," said Patalamon. "He's unlucky. Do you really think he's old Zaharoff come back? I owe him for some gull's eggs."
"Don't look at him," said Carrick. "Hit off that drove of 4-year-olds. The men ought to skin 200 today, but it's the beginning of the season and they are new to the work. 100 will do. Quick!"
Patalamon rattled a pair of seal's shoulder bones in front of a herd of holluschickie, and they stopped dead, puffing and blowing. Then he stepped near, and the seals began to move, and Carrick headed them inland, and they never tried to get back to their companions. Hundreds and hundreds of thousands of seals watched them being driven, but they went on playing just the same. Kotick was the only one who asked questions, and none of his companions could tell him anything, except that the men always drove seals in that way for 6 weeks or 2 months of every year. "I am going to follow," he said, and his eyes nearly popped out of his head as he shuffled along in the wake of the herd.
"The white seal is coming after us," cried Patalamon. "That's the first time a seal has ever come to the killing grounds alone."
"Shh, don't look behind you," said Carrick. "It is Zaharoff's ghost. I must speak to the priest about this."
The distance to the killing grounds was only half a mile, but it took an hour to cover, because if the seals went too fast, Carrick knew that they would get heated, and then their fur would come off in patches when they were skinned. So they went on very slowly, past Sea Lion's Neck, past Webster House, till they came to the salt house just beyond the sight of the seals on the beach. Kotick followed, panting and wondering. He thought that he was at the world's end, but the roar of the seal nurseries behind him sounded as loud as the roar of a train in a tunnel. Then Carrick sat down on the moss and pulled out a heavy pewter watch and let the drove cool off for 30 minutes, and Kotick could hear the fog dew dripping off the brim of his cap. Then 10 or 12 men, each with an iron-bound club 3 or 4 feet long, came up, and Carrick pointed out 1 or 2 of the drove that were bitten by their companions or too hot, and the men kicked those aside with their heavy boots made of the skin of a walrus's throat, and then Carrick said, "Let go!" and the men clubbed the seals on the head as fast as they could. 10 minutes later, little Kotick did not recognize his friends any more, for their skins were ripped off from the nose to the hind flippers, whipped off, and thrown down on the ground in a pile. That was enough for Kotick. He turned and galloped, a seal can gallop very swiftly for a short time, back to the sea, his little new mustache bristling with horror. At Sea Lion's Neck, where the great sea lions sit on the edge of the surf, he flung himself flipper overhead into the cool water and rocked there, gasping miserably.
"What's here?" said a sea lion gruffly, for it is a rule that the sea lions keep themselves to themselves.
"Schooney, oaken schooney! I'm lonesome, very lonesome," said Kotick. "They're killing all the holluschickie on the beaches."
The sea lion turned his head inshore.
"Nonsense," he said. "Your friends are making as much noise as ever. You must have seen old Carrick polishing off a drove. He's done that for 30 years.
"It's horrible," said Kotick, backing water as a wave went over him, and steadying himself with a screw stroke of his flippers that brought him all standing within 3 inches of a jagged edge of rock.
"Well done for a yearling," said the sea lion, who could appreciate good swimming. "I suppose it is rather awful from your way of looking at it, but if you seals will come here year after year, of course the men get to know of it, and unless you can find an island where no men ever come, you will always be driven."
"Isn't there any such island?" began Kotick.
"I've followed the pultus, the halibut, for 20 years, and I can't say I've found it yet. But look here, you seem to have a fondness for talking to your betters. Suppose you go to Walrus Islet and talk to Seavitch. He may know something. Don't flounce off like that. It's a 6-mile swim, and if I were you, I should haul out and take a nap first, little one."
Kotick thought that was good advice, so he swam round to his own beach, hauled out, and slept for 30 minutes, twitching all over, as seals will. Then he headed straight for Walrus Islet, a little low sheet of rocky island almost due northeast from Novastoshnya, all ledges and rock and gulls' nests where the walrus herded by themselves. He landed close to old Seavitch, the big, ugly, bloated, pimpled, fat-necked, long-tusked walrus of the North Pacific who has no manners except when he's asleep, as he was then, with his hind flippers half in and half out of the surf.
"Wake up!" barked Kotick, for the gulls were making a great noise.
"What's that?" said Seavitch, and he struck the next walrus a blow with his tusks and waked him up, and the next struck the next, and so on till they were all awake and staring in every direction but the right one.
"Hi, it's me," said Kotick, bobbing in the surf and looking like a little white slug.
"Well, may I be skinned," said Seavitch, and they all looked at Kotick, as you can fancy a club full of drowsy old gentlemen would look at a little boy.
Kotick did not care to hear any more about skinning just then. He had seen enough of it, so he called out, "Isn't there any place for seals to go where men don't ever come?"
"Go and find out," said Sea Vitch, shutting his eyes. "Run away, we're busy here."
Kotick made his dolphin jump in the air and shouted as loud as he could, "Clam eater, clam eater!" He knew that Sea Vitch never caught a fish in his life, but always rooted for clams and seaweed, though he pretended to be a very terrible person. Naturally, the Chickies and Guvaruskies and the Apatkas, the Burgomaster Gulls and the Kittywakes and the Puffins, who were always looking for a chance to be rude, took up the cry, and, so Limmershin told me, for nearly 5 minutes you could not have heard a gun fired on Walrus Islet. All the population was yelling and screaming, "Clam-eater! Stareek, old man!" while Sea Vitch rolled from side to side, grunting and coughing. End of section 10.
Section number 11 of The Jungle Book. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Louise Cambou. The Jungle Book by Rudyard Kipling. The White Seal, Part 2. "Now will you tell?" said Kotick, all out of breath. "Go and ask Sea Cow," said Sea Vitch. "If he is living still, he'll be able to tell you." "How shall I know Sea Cow when I meet him?" said Kotick, sheering off. "He's the only thing in the sea uglier than Sea Vitch," screamed a Burgomaster Gull, wheeling under Sea Vitch's nose. "Uglier and with worse manners. Stareek!" Kotick swam back to Novastoshnah, leaving the gulls to scream. There he found that no one sympathized with him in his little attempt to discover a quiet place for the seals. They told him that men had always driven the holluschickie, it was part of the day's work, and that if he did not like to see ugly things, he should not have gone to the killing grounds. But none of the other seals had seen the killing, and that made the difference between him and his friends. Besides, Kotick was a white seal. "What you must do," said old Sea Catch, after he had heard his son's adventures, "is to grow up and be a big seal like your father, and have a nursery on the beach, and then they will leave you alone. In another 5 years, you ought to be able to fight for yourself." Even gentle Makta, his mother, said, "You will never be able to stop the killing. Go and play in the sea, Kotick." And Kotick went off and danced the fire dance with a very heavy little heart. That autumn, he left the beach as soon as he could, and set off alone because of a notion in his bullet head. He was going to find Sea Cow, if there was such a person in the sea, and he was going to find a quiet island with good firm beaches for seals to live on, where men could not get at them. So he explored and explored by himself, from the north to the south Pacific, swimming as much as 300 miles in a day and a night. He met with more adventures than can be told, and narrowly escaped being caught by the basking shark, and the spotted shark, and the hammerhead. And he met all the untrustworthy ruffians that loaf up and down the seas, and the heavy polite fish, and the scarlet spotted scallops that are moored in one place for hundreds of years, and grow very proud of it. But he never met Sea Cow, and he never found an island that he could fancy. If the beach was good and hard with a slope behind it for seals to play on, there was always the smoke of a whaler on the horizon, boiling down blubber, and Kotick knew what that meant. Or else he could see that seals had once visited the island and been killed off, and Kotick knew that where men had come once, they would come again. He picked up with an old stumpy-tailed albatross, who told him that Kerguelen Island was the very place for peace and quiet, and when Kotick went down there, he was all but smashed to pieces against some wicked black cliffs in a heavy sleet storm, with lightning and thunder. Yet, as he pulled out against the gale, he could see that even there had once been a seal nursery, and it was so in all the other islands that he visited. Limmershin gave a long list of them, for he said that Kotick spent 5 seasons exploring, with a 4-month rest each year at Novastoshnah, when the holluschickie used to make fun of him and his imaginary islands. He went to the Galapagos, a horrid dry place on the equator, where he was nearly baked to death. He went to the Georgia Islands, the Orkneys, Emerald Island, Little Nightingale Island, Goes Island, Bouvet's Island, the Crossets, and even to a little speck of an island south of the Cape of Good Hope. But everywhere the people of the sea told him the same things. Seals had come to those islands once upon a time, but men had killed them all off. Even when he swam thousands of miles out to the Pacific and got to a place called Cape Corrientes, that was when he was coming back from Goes Island, he found a few hundred mangy seals on a rock, and they told him that men came there too. That nearly broke his heart, and he headed round the Horn, back to his own beaches. And on his way north, he hauled out on an island full of green trees, where he found an old, old seal who was dying. And Kotick caught fish for him and told him all his sorrows. "Now," said Kotick, "I am going back to Novastoshnah, and if I am driven to the killing pens with the holluschickie, I shall not care." The old seal said, "Try once more. I am the last of the lost rookery of Massafuera. And in the days where men killed us by the 100,000, there was a story on the beaches that some day a white seal would come out of the north and lead the seal people to a quiet place. I am old, and I shall never live to see that day, but others will. Try once more." And Kotick curled up his moustache, it was a beauty, and said, "I am the only white seal that has ever been born on the beaches, and I am the only seal, black or white, who ever thought of looking for new islands." This cheered him immensely, and when he came back to Novastoshnah that summer, Matka, his mother, begged him to marry and settle down, for he was no longer a holluschick, but a full-grown sea-catch, with a curly white mane on his shoulders, as heavy, as big, and as fierce as his father. "Give me another season," he said. "Remember, mother, it is always the 7th wave that goes farthest up the beach." Curiously enough, there was another seal who thought that she would put off marrying till the next year, and Kotick danced the fire dance with her all down Lukannon Beach the night before he set off on his last exploration. This time he went westward, because he had fallen on the trail of a great shoal of halibut, and he needed at least 100 pounds of fish a day to keep him in good condition. He chased them till he was tired, and then he curled himself up and went to sleep on the hollows of the ground swell that sets into Copper Island. He knew the coast perfectly well, so about midnight, when he felt himself gently bumped on a weed bed, he said, "Tide's running strong tonight," and turning over under water, opened his eyes slowly and stretched. Then he jumped like a cat, for he saw huge things nosing about in the shoal water and browsing on the heavy fringes of the weeds. "By the great combers of Magellan," he said beneath his moustache, "who in the deep sea are these people?" They were like no walrus, sea lion, seal, bear, whale, shark, fish, squid, or scallop that Kotick had ever seen before. They were between 20 and 30 feet long, and they had no hind flippers, but a shovel-like tail that looked as if it had been whittled out of wet leather. Their heads were the most foolish-looking things you ever saw, and they balanced on the ends of their tails in deep water when they weren't grazing, bowing solemnly to each other and waving their front flippers as a fat man waves his arm. "Ahem," said Kotick. "Good sport, gentlemen." The big things answered by bowing and waving their flippers like the frog footmen. When they began feeding again, Kotick saw that their upper lip was split into two pieces, that they could twitch apart about a foot and bring together again with a whole bushel of seaweed between the splits. They tucked the stuff into their mouths and chomped solemnly. "Messy style of feeding, that," said Kotick. They bowed again, and Kotick began to lose his temper. "Very good," he said. If you do happen to have an extra joint in your front flipper, you needn't show off so. I see you bow gracefully, but I should like to know your names." The split lips moved and twitched, and the glassy green eyes stared, but they did not speak. "Well," said Kotick, "you're the only people I've ever met uglier than Sivich, and with worse manners." Then he remembered in a flash what the burgomaster gull had screamed to him when he was a little yearling at Walrus Islet, and he tumbled backwards in the water, for he knew that he had found sea cow at last. The sea cows went on schlooping and grazing and chumping in the weed, and Kotick asked them questions in every language that he had picked up in his travels, and the sea people talk nearly as many languages as human beings. But the sea cows did not answer, because sea cow could not talk. He has only 6 bones in his neck where he ought to have 7, and they say under the sea that that prevents him from speaking even to his companions. But, as you know, he has an extra joint in his foreflipper, and by waving it up and down and about, he makes what answers to a sort of clumsy telegraphic code. By daylight, Kotick's mane was standing on end, and his temper was gone where the dead crabs go. Then the sea cow began to travel northward very slowly, stopping to hold absurd bowing councils from time to time, and Kotick followed them, saying to himself, "People who are such idiots as these are would have been killed long ago if they hadn't found out some safe island. And what is good enough for the sea cow is good enough for the sea catch. All the same, I wish they'd hurry." It was weary work for Kotick. The herd never went more than 40 or 50 miles a day, and stopped to feed at night, and kept close to the shore all the time, while Kotick swam around them, and over them, and under them, but he could not hurry them up 1/2 mile. As they went farther north, they held a bowing council every few hours, and Kotick nearly bit off his moustache with impatience till he saw that they were following up a warm current of water, and then he respected them more. One night they sank through the shiny water, sank like stones, and for the first time since he had known them, began to swim quickly. Kotick followed, and the pace astonished him, for he never dreamed that sea cow was anything of a swimmer. They headed for a cliff by the shore, a cliff that ran down into deep water and plunged into a dark hole at the foot of it, 20 fathoms under the sea. It was a long, long swim, and Kotick badly wanted fresh air before he was out of the dark tunnel they led him through. "My wig," he said, when he rose, gasping and puffing, into open water at the farther end. It was a long dive, but it was worth it. The sea cows had separated and were browsing lazily along the edges of the finest beaches that Kotick had ever seen. There were long stretches of smooth-worn rock running for miles, exactly fitted to make seal nurseries, and there were playgrounds of hard sand sloping inland behind them, and there were rollers for seals to dance in, and long grass to roll in, and sand dunes to climb up and down, and, best of all, Kotick knew by the feel of the water, which never deceives a true sea catch, that no men had ever come there. The first thing he did was to assure himself that the fishing was good, and then he swam along the beaches and counted up the delightful low sandy islands half hidden in the beautiful rolling fog. Away to the northward, out to sea, ran a line of bars and shoals and rocks that would never let a ship come within 6 miles of the beach, and between the islands and the mainland was a stretch of deep water that ran up to the perpendicular cliffs, and somewhere below the cliffs were the mouth of the tunnel. "It's Novastoshnah over again, but 10 times better," said Kotick. "Sea cow must be wiser than I thought. Men can't come down the cliffs, even if they were any men, and the shoals to seaward would knock a ship to splinters. If any place in the sea is safe, this is it." He began to think of the seal he had left behind him, but though he was in the hurry to go back to Novastoshnah, he thoroughly explored the new country, so that he would be able to answer all questions. Then he dived, and made sure of the mouth of the tunnel, and raced through to the southward. No one but a sea cow or a seal would have dreamed of there being such a place, and when he looked back at the cliffs, even Kotick could hardly believe that he had been under them. He was 6 days going home, though he was not swimming slowly, and when he hauled out just above Sea Lion's neck, the first person he met was the seal who had been waiting for him, and she saw by the look in his eyes that he had found his island at last. But the Holushiki and Sea Catch, his father, and all the other seals, laughed at him when he told them what he had discovered, and a young seal about his own age said, "This is all very well, Kotick, but you can't come from no one knows where and order us off like this. Remember, we've been fighting for our nurseries, and that's a thing you never did. You preferred prowling about in the sea." The other seals laughed at this, and the young seal began twisting his head from side to side. He had just married that year, and was making a great fuss about it. "I've no nursery to fight for," said Kotick. "I only want to show you all a place where you will be safe. What's the use of fighting?" "Oh, if you're trying to back out, of course I've no more to say," said the young seal with an ugly chuckle. "Will you come with me if I win?" said Kotick, and a green light came into his eye, for he was very angry at having to fight at all. "Very good," said the young seal carelessly. "If you win, I'll come." He had no time to change his mind, for Kotick's head was out and his teeth sunk in the blubber of the young seal's neck. Then he threw himself back on his haunches and hauled his enemy down the beach, shook him, and knocked him over. Then Kotick roared to the seals, "I've done my best for you these 5 seasons past. I found you the island where you'll be safe, but unless your heads are dragged off your silly necks, you won't believe. I'm going to teach you now. Look out for yourselves." Limeshin told me that never in his life, and Limeshin sees 10,000 big seals fighting every year, never in all his life did he see anything like Kotick's charge into the nurseries. He flung himself at the biggest sea catch he could find, caught him by the throat, choked him, and bumped him, and banged him, till he grunted for mercy, and then threw him aside and attacked the next. You see, Kotick had never fasted for 4 months, as the big seals did every year, and his deep-sea swimming trips kept him in perfect condition, and, best of all, he had never fought before. His curly white mane stood up with rage, and his eyes flamed, and his big dog teeth glistened, and he was splendid to look at. Old Sea Catch, his father, saw him tearing past, hauling the grizzled old seals about as though they had been halibut, and upsetting the young bachelors in all directions. And Sea Catch gave a roar and shouted, "He may be a fool, but he's the best fighter on the beaches. Don't tackle your father, my son. He's with you." Kotick roared in answer, and old Sea Catch waddled in with his mustache on end, blowing like a locomotive, while Matt and the seal that was going to marry Kotick cowered down and admired their menfolk. It was a gorgeous fight, for the two fought as long as there was a seal that dared lift up his head, and when there were none, they paraded grandly up and down the beach, side by side, bellowing. At night, just as the northern lights were winking and flashing through the fog, Kotick climbed a bare rock and looked down on the scattered nurseries and the torn and bleeding seals. "Now," he said, "I've taught you your lesson." "My wig," said old Sea Catch, boosting himself up stiffly, for he was fearfully mauled. "The killer whale himself could not have cut them up worse. Son, I'm proud of you, and what's more, I'll come with you to your island, if there is such a place." "Hear you, fat pigs of the sea, who comes with me to the sea cow's tunnel? Answer, or I shall teach you again," roared Kotick. There was a murmur like the ripple of the tide all up and down the beaches. "We will come," said thousands of tired voices. "We will follow Kotick, the white seal." Then Kotick dropped his head between his shoulders and shut his eyes proudly. He was not a white seal any more, but red from head to tail. All the same, he would have scorned to look at or touch one of his wounds. A week later, he and his army, nearly 10,000 Holushiki and old seals, went away north to the sea cow's tunnel, Kotick leading them, and the seals that stayed at Novastoshnah called them idiots. But next spring, when they all met off the fishing banks of the Pacific, Kotick's seals took such tales of the new beaches beyond Sea Cow's tunnel that more and more seals left Novastoshnah. Of course, it was not all done at once, for the seals are not very clever, and they need a long time to turn things over in their minds. But year after year, more seals went away from Novastoshnah and Lukannon and the other nurseries to the quiet, sheltered beaches where Kotick sits all the summer through, getting bigger and fatter and stronger each year, while the holluschickie play around him in that sea where no man comes. End of section number 11. Recording by Louise Cambo. 11. Recording by Louise Cambo. 11. Recording by Louise Cambo.
Section 12 of The Jungle Book. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Jungle Book by Rudyard Kipling. Lukannon. This is the great deep sea song that all the St. Paul seals sing when they are heading back to their beaches in the summer. It is a sort of very sad seal national anthem. I met my mates in the morning, and oh, but I am old, where roaring on the ledges the summer ground swell rolled. I heard them lift the chorus that drowned the breaker's song. The beaches of Lukannon, 2 million voices strong, the song of pleasant stations beside the salt lagoons, the song of blowing squadrons that shuffle down the dunes, the song of midnight dances that churn the sea to flame. The beaches of Lukannon, before the sealers came, I met my mates in the morning. I'll never meet them more. They came and went in legions that darkened all the shore, and all the foam flecked offing as far as voice could reach. We hailed the landing parties and we sang them up the beach, the beaches of Lukannon, the winter wheat so tall, the dripping crinkled lichens and the sea fog drenching all. The platforms of our playground, all shining smooth and worn, the beaches of Lukannon, the home where we were born. I met my mates in the morning, a broken scattered band, men shoot us in the water and club us on the land, men drive us to the salt house like silly sheep and tame, and still we sing Lukannon before the sealers came. Wheel down to southward, oh, Gouvruskago, and tell the deep sea viceroys the story of our woe. Here empty as the shark's egg, the tempest flings ashore, the beaches of Lukannon shall know their sons no more. End of section 12. Recording by Iswa in Belgium in December 2014.
Section 13 of The Jungle Book. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Vanessa Cooley in Quinlan, Texas. The Jungle Book by Rudyard Kipling. Rikki-Tikki-Tavi, Part 1. A the hole where he went in, Red Eye called to Wrinkleskin, "Hear what little Red Eye saith, Nag, come up and dance with death, eye to eye and head to head, keep the measure, Nag. This shall end when one is dead, at thy pleasure, Nag. Turn for turn and twist for twist, run and hide thee, Nag. Ha! The hooded death has missed. Woe betide thee, Nag." This is the story of the great war that Rikki-Tikki-Tavi fought single-handedly through the bathrooms of the big bungalow in Sigauli cantonment. Darzee, the tailor bird, helped him, and Chuchandra, the muskrat, who never comes out into the middle of the floor, but always creeps round by the wall, gave him advice. But Rikki-Tikki did the real fighting. He was a mongoose, rather like a little cat in his fur and his tail, but quite like a weasel in his head and his habits. His eyes and the end of his restless nose were pink. He could scratch himself anywhere he pleased with any leg, front or back, that he chose to use. He could fluff up his tail till it looked like a bottle brush, and his war cry as he scuttled through the long grass was, "Rikki-tikki-tikki-tikki-tikki." One day, a high summer flood washed him out of the burrow where he lived with his father and mother, and carried him kicking and clucking down a roadside ditch. He found a little wisp of grass floating there and clung to it till he lost his senses. When he revived, he was lying in the hot sun on the middle of a garden path, very draggled indeed, and a small boy was saying, "Here's a dead mongoose. Let's have a funeral." "No," said his mother. "Let's take him in and dry him. Perhaps he isn't really dead." They took him into the house, and a big man picked him up between his finger and thumb, and said that he was not dead, but half choked. So they wrapped him in cotton wool and warmed him over a little fire, and he opened his eyes and sneezed. "No," said the big man. He was an Englishman who had just moved into the bungalow. "Don't frighten him, and we'll see what he'll do." It is the hardest thing in the world to frighten a mongoose, because he is eaten up from nose to tail with curiosity. The motto of all the mongoose family is "Run and find out," and Rikki-Tikki was a true mongoose. He looked at the cotton wool, decided it was not good to eat, ran all around the table, sat up and put his fur in order, scratched himself, and jumped on the small boy's shoulder.
"Don't be frightened, Teddy," said his father. "That's his way of making friends."
"Ouch! He's tickling under my chin," said Teddy.
Rikki-Tikki looked down between the boy's collar and neck, snuffed at his ear, and climbed down to the floor, where he sat rubbing his nose.
"Good gracious," said Teddy's mother, "and that's a wild creature. I suppose he's so tame because we've been kind to him."
"All mongooses are like that," said her husband. "If Teddy doesn't pick him up by the tail or try to put him in a cage, he'll run in and out of the house all day long. Let's give him something to eat."
They gave him a little piece of raw meat. Rikki-Tikki liked it immensely, and when it was finished, he went out into the veranda and sat in the sunshine and fluffed up his fur to make it dry to the roots. Then he felt better.
"There are more things to find out about in this house," he said to himself, "than all my family could find out in all their lives. I shall certainly stay and find out."
He spent all day roaming over the house. He nearly drowned himself in the bathtubs, put his nose into the ink on a writing table, and burned it on the end of the big man's cigar, for he climbed up in the big man's lap to see how writing was done. At nightfall, he ran into Teddy's nursery to watch how kerosene lamps were lighted, and when Teddy went to bed, Rikki-Tikki climbed up too. But he was a restless companion, because he had to get up and attend to every noise all through the night, and find out what made it. Teddy's mother and father came in, the last thing, to look at their boy, and Rikki-Tikki was awake on the pillow.
"I don't like that," said Teddy's mother. "He may bite the child."
"He'll do no such thing," said the father. "Teddy's far safer with that little beast than if he had a bloodhound to watch him. If a snake came into the nursery now..."
But Teddy's mother wouldn't think of anything so awful. Early in the morning, Rikki-Tikki came to early breakfast in the veranda, riding on Teddy's shoulder, and they gave him banana and some boiled egg. He sat on all their laps, one after the other, because every well-brought-up mongoose always hopes to be a house mongoose some day, and have rooms to run about in, and Rikki-Tikki's mother, she used to live in the general's house at Sigali, had carefully told Rikki what to do if he ever came across white men. Then Rikki-Tikki went out into the garden to see what was to be seen. It was a large garden, only half cultivated, with bushes as big as summer houses, of martial neel roses,
lime and orange trees, clumps of bamboos, and thickets of high grass. Rikki-Tikki licked his lips. "This is a splendid hunting ground," he said, and his tail grew bottle-brushy at the thought of it, and he scuttled up and down the garden, snuffing here and there, till he heard a very sorrowful voices in a thorn bush. It was Darzee, the tailor bird, and his wife. They had made a beautiful nest by pulling two big leaves together and stitching them up the edges with fibers, and had filled the hollow with cotton and downy fluff. The nest swayed to and fro as they sat on the rim and cried. "What is the matter?" asked Rikki-Tikki. "We are very miserable," said Darzee. "One of our babies fell out of the nest yesterday and Nag ate him." "Hmm," said Rikki-Tikki. "That is very sad, but I'm a stranger here. Who is Nag?" Darzee and his wife only cowered down in the nest without answering, for from the thick grass at the foot of the bush there came a low hiss, a horrid cold sound that made Rikki-Tikki jump back 2 clear feet. Then, inch by inch out of the grass, rose up the head and spread hood of Nag, the big black cobra, and he was 5 feet long from tongue to tail. When he had lifted 1/3 of himself clear of the ground, he swayed, balancing to and fro, exactly as a dandelion tuft balances in the wind, and he looked at Rikki-Tikki with the wicked snake's eyes that never change their expression, whatever the snake may be thinking of. "Who is Nag?" said he. "I am Nag. The great god Brahm put his mark upon all our people when the first cobra spread his hood to keep the sun off Brahm as he slept. Look and be afraid."
He spread out his hood more than ever, and Rikki-Tikki saw the spectacle mark on the back of it that looks exactly like the eye part of a hook and eye fastening. He was afraid for a minute, but it is impossible for a mongoose to stay frightened for any length of time, and though Rikki-Tikki had never met a live cobra before, his mother had fed him on dead ones, and he knew that all a grown mongoose's business in life was to fight and eat snakes. Nag knew that too, and at the bottom of his cold heart, he was afraid. "Well," said Rikki-Tikki, and his tail began to fluff up again, "marks or no marks, do you think it is right for you to eat fledglings out of a nest?" Nag was thinking to himself and watching the least little movement in the grass behind Rikki-Tikki. He knew that mongooses in the garden meant death sooner or later for him and his family, but he wanted to get Rikki-Tikki off his guard, so he drooped his head a little and put it on one side.
"Let us talk," he said. "You eat eggs. Why should not I eat birds?"
"Behind you! Look behind you!"
sang Darzee. Rikki-Tikki knew better than to waste time in staring. He jumped up in the air as high as he could go, and just under him whizzed by the head of Nagaina, Nag's wicked wife. She had crept up behind him as he was talking to make an end of him. He heard her savage hiss as the stroke missed. He came down almost across her back, and if he had been an old mongoose, he would have known that then was the time to break her back with one bite. But he was afraid of the terrible, lashing return stroke of the cobra. He bit, indeed, but did not bite long enough, and he jumped clear of the whisking tail, leaving Nagaina torn and angry.
"Wicked, wicked Darzee,"
said Nag, lashing up as high as he could reach toward the nest in the thorn bush. But Darzee had built it out of the reach of snakes, and it only swayed to and fro. Rikki-Tikki felt his eyes growing red and hot. When a mongoose's eyes grow red, he is angry, and he sat back on his tail and hind legs, like a little kangaroo, and looked all around him, and chattered with rage. But Nag and Nagaina had disappeared into the grass. When a snake misses its stroke, it never says anything or gives any sign of what it means to do next. Rikki-Tikki did not care to follow them, for he did not feel sure that he could manage 2 snakes at once. So he trotted off to the gravel path near the house, and sat down to think. It was a serious matter for him. If you read the old books of natural history, you will find they say that when the mongoose fights a snake and happens to get bitten, he runs off and eats some herb that cures him. That is not true. The victory is only a matter of quickness of eye and quickness of foot. Snakes blow against mongoose's jump. And as no eye can follow the motion of a snake's head when it strikes, this makes things much more wonderful than any magic herb. Rikki-Tikki knew that he was a young mongoose, and it made him all the more pleased to think that he had managed to escape a blow from behind. It gave him confidence in himself, and when Teddy came running down the path, Rikki-Tikki was ready to be petted. But just as Teddy was stooping, something wriggled a little in the dust, and a tiny voice said,
"Be careful! I am death!"
It was Karat, the dusty brown snakeling that lies for choice on the dusty earth, and his bite is as dangerous as the cobra's, but he is so small that nobody thinks of him, and so he does the more harm to people. Rikki-Tikki's eyes grew red again, and he danced up to Karat with the peculiar rocking, swaying motion that he had inherited from his family. It looks very funny, but it is so perfectly balanced a gait that you can fly off it from any angle you please, and in dealing with snakes, this is an advantage. If Rikki-Tikki had only known, he was doing a much more dangerous thing than fighting Nag, for Karat is so small and can turn so quickly that unless Rikki bit him close to the back of the head, he would get the return stroke in his eye or his lip. But Rikki did not know. His eyes were all red, and he rocked back and forth, looking for a good place to hold. Karat struck out. Rikki jumped sideways and tried to run in, but the wicked little dusty gray head lashed within a fraction of his shoulder, and he had to jump over the body, and the head followed his heels close. Teddy shouted to the house,
"Oh, look here! Our mongoose is killing a snake!"
And Rikki-Tikki heard a scream from Teddy's mother. His father ran out with a stick, but by the time he had come up, Karat had lunged out once too far, and Rikki-Tikki had sprung, jumped on the snake's back, dropped his head far between his forelegs, bitten as high up the back as he could get hold, and rolled away. That bite paralyzed Karat, and Rikki-Tikki was just going to eat him up from the tail, after the custom of his family at dinner, when he remembered that a full meal makes a slow mongoose, and if he wanted all his strength and quickness ready, he must keep himself thin. He went away for a dust bath under the castor oil bushes, while Teddy's father beat the dead Karat. "What is the use of that?" thought Rikki-Tikki. "I have settled it all." And then Teddy's mother picked him up from the dust and hugged him, crying that he had saved Teddy from death, and Teddy's father said that he was a providence, and Teddy looked on with big, scared eyes. Rikki-Tikki was rather amused at all the fuss, which, of course, he did not understand. Teddy's mother might just as well have petted Teddy for playing in the dust. Rikki was thoroughly enjoying himself. That night at dinner, walking to and fro among the wine glasses on the table, he might have stuffed himself three times over with nice things, but he remembered Nag and Nagaina, and though it was very pleasant to be patted and petted by Teddy's mother and to sit on Teddy's shoulder, his eyes would get red from time to time, and he would go off into his long roar cry of "Rikki-Tikki-Tikki-Tikki-Tikki." Teddy carried him off to bed and insisted on Rikki-Tikki sleeping under his chin. Rikki-Tikki was too well-bred to bite or scratch, but as soon as Teddy was asleep, he went off for his nightly walk around the house, and in the dark he ran up against Chuchundra, the muskrat, creeping around by the wall. Chuchundra is a broken-hearted little beast. He whimpers and cheeps all night, trying to make up his mind to run into the middle of the room, but he never gets there.
"Don't kill me,"
said Chuchundra, almost weeping.
"Rikki-Tikki, don't kill me."
"Do you think a snake killer kills muskrats?"
said Rikki-Tikki scornfully.
"Those who kill snakes get killed by snakes,"
said Chuchundra, more sorrowfully than ever.
"And how am I to be sure that Nag won't mistake me for you some dark night?"
"There's not the least danger," said Rikki-Tikki. "But Nag is in the garden, and I know you don't go there."
"My cousin, Chua the rat, told me,"
said Chuchundra, and then he stopped.
"Told you what?"
"Hush! Nag is everywhere, Rikki-Tikki. You should have talked to Chua in the garden."
"I didn't, so you must tell me. Quick, Chuchundra, or I'll bite you."
Chuchundra sat down and cried, till the tears rolled off his whiskers.
"I am a very poor man,"
he sobbed.
"I never had the spirit enough to run out into the middle of the room. Hush! I mustn't tell you anything. Can't you hear, Rikki-Tikki?"
Rikki-Tikki listened. The house was as still, but he thought he could just catch the faintest scratch-scratch in the world. A noise as faint as that of a wasp walking on a windowpane, the dry scratch of a snake's scales on brickwork.
"That's Nag or Nagaina," he said to himself, "and he is crawling into the bathroom sluice. You're right, Chuchundra, I should have talked to Chua."
He stole off to Teddy's bathroom, but there was nothing there, and then to Teddy's mother's bathroom. At the bottom of the smooth plaster wall, there was a brick pulled out to make a sluice for the bathwater, And as Rikki-Tikki stole in by the masonry curb where the bath is put, he heard Nag and Nagaina whispering together outside in the moonlight.
"When the house is emptied of people," said Nagaina to her husband, "he will have to go away, and then the garden will be our own again. Go in quietly, and remember that the big man who killed Karat is the first one to bite. Then come out and tell me, and we will hunt for Rikki-Tikki together." "But are you sure that there is anything to be gained by killing the people?" said Nag. "Everything. When there were no people in the bungalow, did we have any mongoose in the garden? So long as the bungalow is empty, we are king and queen of the garden. And remember that as soon as our eggs in the melon bed hatch, as they may tomorrow, our children will need room and quiet."
"I had not thought of that," said Nag. "I will go, but there is no need that we should hunt for Rikki-Tikki afterward. I will kill the big man and his wife, and the child if I can, and come away quietly. Then the bungalow will be empty, and Rikki-Tikki will go."
End of section 13 of The Jungle Book, Rikki-Tikki-Tavi, part 1. Section 14 of The Jungle Book. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Vanessa Cooley in Quinlan, Texas. The Jungle Book by Rudyard Kipling. Rikki-Tikki-Tavi, Part 2. Rikki-Tikki tingled all over with rage and hatred at this, and then Nag's head came through the sluice, and his 5 feet of cold body followed it. Angry as he was, Rikki-Tikki was very frightened as he saw the size of the big cobra. Nag coiled himself up, raised his head, and looked into the bathroom in the dark, and Rikki could see his eyes glitter. "Now, if I kill him here, Nagaina will know, and if I fight him on the open floor, the odds are in his favor. What am I to do?" said Rikki-Tikki-Tavi. Nag waved to and fro, and then Rikki-Tikki heard him drinking from the biggest water jug that was used to fill the bath.
"That is good," said the snake. "Now, when Karat was killed, the big man had a stick. You may have that stick still, but when he comes in to bathe in the morning, he will not have a stick. I shall wait here till he comes. Nagaina, do you hear me? I shall wait here in the cool till daytime."
There was no answer from outside, so Rikki-Tikki knew Nagaina had gone away. Nag coiled himself down, coil by coil, round the bulge at the bottom of the water jar, and Rikki-Tikki stayed as still as death. After an hour he began to move, muscle by muscle, toward the jar. Nag was asleep, and Rikki-Tikki looked at his big back, wondering which would be the best place for a good hold. "If I don't break his back at the first jump," said Rikki, "he can still fight. And if he fights, oh, Rikki!" He looked at the thickness of the neck below the hood, but that was too much for him, and a bite near the tail would only make Nag savage. "It must be the head," he said at last. "The head above the hood. And when I am once there, I must not let go." Then he jumped. The head was lying a little clear of the water jar under the curve of it, and as his teeth met, Rikki braced his back against the bulge of the red earthenware to hold down the head. This gave him just 1 second's purchase, and he made the most of it. Then he was battered to and fro as a rat is shaken by a dog, to and fro on the floor, up and down and around in great circles, but his eyes were red and he held on as the body cart-whipped over the floor, upsetting the tin dipper and the soap dish and the flesh brush and banged against the tin side of the bath. As he held, he closed his jaws tighter and tighter, for he made sure he would be banged to death, and for the honor of his family he preferred to be found with his teeth locked.
He was dizzy, aching, and felt shaken to pieces when something went off like a thunderclap just behind him. A hot wind knocked him senseless, and red fire singed his fur. The big man had been wakened by the noise and had fired both barrels of a shotgun into Nag just behind the hood. Rikki-Tikki held on with his eyes shut, for now he was quite sure he was dead. But the head did not move, and the big man picked him up and said, "It's the mongoose again, Alice. The little chap has saved our lives now." Then Teddy's mother came in with a very white face and saw what was left of Nag, and Rikki-Tikki dragged himself to Teddy's bedroom and spent half the rest of the night shaking himself tenderly to find out whether he really was broken into 40 pieces, as he fancied. When morning came, he was very stiff, but well pleased with his doings. "Now I have Nagaina to settle with, and she will be worse than 5 Nags, and there's no knowing when the eggs she spoke of will hatch. Goodness, I must go and see Darzee," he said. Without waiting for breakfast, Rikki-Tikki ran to the thorn bush where Darzee was singing a song of triumph at the top of his voice. The news of Nag's death was all over the garden, for the sweeper had thrown the body on the rubbish heap. "Oh, you stupid tuft of feathers," said Rikki-Tikki angrily. "Is this the time to sing? Nag is dead, is dead, is dead," sang Darzee. "The valiant Rikki-Tikki caught him by the head and held fast. The big man brought the bang stick, and Nag fell into pieces. He will never eat my babies again." "All that's true enough, but where is Nagaina?" said Rikki-Tikki, looking carefully around him. "Nagaina came to the bathroom sluice and called for Nag," Darzee went on. "And Nag came out on the end of a stick. The sweeper picked him up on the end of a stick and threw him upon the rubbish heap. Let us sing about the great red-eyed Rikki-Tikki." And Darzee filled his throat and sang. "If I could get up to your nest, I'd roll your babies out," said Rikki-Tikki. "You don't know when to do the right thing at the right time. You're safe enough in your nest there, but it's war for me down here. Stop singing a minute, Darzee." "For the great, the beautiful Rikki-Tikki's sake, I will stop," said Darzee. "What is it, O killer of the terrible Nag?" "Where is Nagaina for the third time?" "On the rubbish heap by the stables, mourning for Nag. Great is Rikki-Tikki with the white teeth." "Bother my white teeth. Have you ever heard where she keeps her eggs?" "In the melon bed, on the end nearest the wall, where the sun strikes nearly all day. She hid them there weeks ago." "And you never thought it worth while to tell me? The end nearest the wall, you said?" "Rikki-Tikki, you are not going to eat her eggs." "Not eat exactly, no. Darzee, if you have a grain of sense, you will fly off to the stables and pretend that your wing is broken and let Nagaina chase you away to this bush. I must get to the melon bed, and if I went there now, she'd see me." Darzee was a feather-brained little fellow who could never hold more than one idea at a time in his head, and just because he knew that Nagaina's children were born in eggs like his own, he didn't think at first it was fair to kill them. But his wife was a sensible bird, and she knew that cobra's eggs meant young cobras later on. So she flew off from the nest and left Darzee to keep the babies warm and continue his song about the death of Nag. Darzee was very like a man in some ways. She fluttered in front of Nagaina by the rubbish heap and cried out, "Oh, my wing is broken! The boy in the house threw a stone at me and broke it!" Then she fluttered more desperately than ever. Nagaina lifted up her head and hissed, "You warned Rikki-Tikki when I would have killed him. Indeed and truly, you've chosen a bad place to be lame in." And she moved toward Darzee's wife, slipping along over the dust.
"The boy broke it with a stone,"
shrieked Darzee's wife.
"Well, it may be some consolation to you when you're dead to know that I shall settle accounts with the boy. My husband lies on the rubbish heap this morning, but before night the boy in the house will lie very still. What is the use of running away? I am sure to catch you. Little fool, look at me."
Darzee's wife knew better than to do that, for a bird who looks at a snake's eyes gets so frightened that she cannot move. Darzee's wife fluttered on, piping sorrowfully and never leaving the ground, and Nagaina quickened her pace.
Rikki-Tikki heard them going up the path from the stables, and he raced for the end of the melon patch near the wall. There, in the warm litter above the melons, very cunningly hidden, he found 25 eggs, about the size of a bantam's eggs, but with whitish skin instead of shell. "I was not a day too soon," he said, for he could see the baby cobras curled up inside the skin, and he knew that the minute they were hatched they could each kill a man or a mongoose. He bit off the tops of the eggs as fast as he could, taking care to crush the young cobras, and turning over the litter from time to time to see whether he had missed any. At last there were only 3 eggs left, and Rikki-Tikki began to chuckle to himself when he heard Darzee's wife screaming, "Rikki-Tikki, I led Nagaina toward the house, and she has gone into the veranda, and, oh, come quickly, she means killing!" Rikki-Tikki smashed 2 eggs and tumbled backward down the melon bed with the 3rd egg in his mouth, and scuttled to the veranda as hard as he could put foot to the ground. Teddy and his mother and father were there at early breakfast, but Rikki-Tikki saw that they were not eating anything. They sat stone still, and their faces were white. Nagaina was coiled up on the matting by Teddy's chair, within easy striking distance of Teddy's bare leg, and she was swaying to and fro, singing a song of triumph. "Son of the big man that killed Nag," she hissed. "Stay still. I am not ready yet. Wait a little. Keep very still, all you 3. If you move, I strike. And if you do not move, I strike. Oh, foolish people who killed my Nag." Teddy's eyes were fixed on his father, and all his father could do was to whisper, "Sit still, Teddy. You mustn't move. Teddy, keep still." Then Rikki-Tikki came up and cried, "Turn round, Nagaina. Turn and fight. All in good time," she said without moving her eyes. "I will settle my account with you presently. Look at your friends, Rikki-Tikki. They are still and white. They are afraid. They dare not move. And if you come a step nearer, I strike." "Look at your eggs," said Rikki-Tikki. "In the melon bed near the wall. Go and look, Nagaina." The big snake turned half around and saw the egg on the veranda. "Ah, give it to me," she said. Rikki-Tikki put his paws one on each side of the egg, and his eyes were blood red. "What price for a snake's egg? For a young cobra? For a young king cobra? For the last, the very last, of the brood? The ants are eating all the others down by the melon bed." Nagaina spun clear around, forgetting everything for the sake of that one egg. Rikki-Tikki saw Teddy's father shoot out a big hand, catch Teddy by the shoulder, and drag him across the little table with the teacups, safe and out of reach of Nagaina. "Tricked! Tricked! Tricked! Rikki-Tikki!" chuckled Rikki-Tikki. "The boy is safe, and it was I that caught Nag by the hood last night in the bathroom." Then he began to jump up and down, all 4 feet together, his head close to the floor. "He threw me to and fro, but he could not shake me off. He was dead before the big man blew him in two. I did it. Rikki-Tikki-Tikki-Tikki! Come then, Nagaina. Come and fight with me. You shall not be a widow long." Nagaina saw that she had lost her chance of killing Teddy, and the egg lay between Rikki-Tikki's paws. "Give me the egg, Rikki-Tikki. Give me the last of my eggs, and I will go away and never come back," she said, lowering her hood. "Yes, you will go away, and you will never come back, for you will go to the rubbish heap with Nag. Fight, widow. The big man has gone for his gun. Fight." Rikki-Tikki was bounding all round Nagaina, keeping just out of reach of her stroke, his little eyes like hot coals. Nagaina gathered herself together and flung out at him. Rikki-Tikki jumped up and backward. Again and again she struck, and each time her head came with a whack on the matting of the veranda, and she gathered herself together like a watch spring. Then Rikki-Tikki danced in a circle to get behind her, and Nagaina spun round to keep her head to his head, so that the rustle of her tail on the matting sounded like dry leaves blown along by the wind. He had forgotten the egg. It still lay on the veranda, and Nagaina came nearer and nearer to it, till at last, while Rikki-Tikki was drawing breath, she caught it in her mouth, turned to the veranda steps, and flew like an arrow down the path, with Rikki-Tikki behind her.
When the cobra runs for her life, she goes like a whiplash flicked across a horse's neck. Rikki-Tikki knew that he must catch her, or all the trouble would begin again. She headed straight for the long grass by the thorn bush, and as he was running, Rikki-Tikki heard Darzee still singing his foolish little song of triumph. But Darzee's wife was wiser. She flew off her nest as Nagaina came along, and flapped her wings about Nagaina's head. If Darzee had helped, they might have turned her, but Nagaina only lowered her hood and went on. Still, the instant's delay brought Rikki-Tikki up to her, and as she plunged into the rat-hole where she and Nag used to live, his little white teeth clenched on her tail, and he went down with her. And very few mongooses, however wise and old they may be, care to follow a cobra into its hole. It was dark in the hole, and Rikki-Tikki never knew when it might open out and give Nagaina room to turn and strike him. He held on savagely, and stuck out his feet to act as brakes on the dark slopes of the hot, moist earth. Then the grass by the mouth of the hole stopped waving, and Darzee said, "It is all over with Rikki-Tikki. We must sing his death song. Valiant Rikki-Tikki is dead, for Nagaina will surely kill him underground." So he sang a very mournful song that he made up on the spur of the minute, and just as he got to the most touching part, the grass quivered again, and Rikki-Tikki, covered with dirt, dragged himself out of the hole, leg by leg, licking his whiskers. Darzee stopped with a little shout. Rikki-Tikki shook some of the dust out of his fur and sneezed. "It is all over," he said. "The widow will never come out again." And the red ants that lived between the grass stems heard him, and began to troop down one after another to see if he had spoken the truth. Rikki-Tikki curled himself up in the grass and slept where he was, slept and slept till it was late in the afternoon, for he had done a hard day's work. "Now," he said when he awoke, "I will go back to the house. Tell the coppersmith, Darzee, and he will tell the garden that Nagaina is dead." The coppersmith is a bird who makes a noise exactly like the beating of a little hammer on a copper pot, and the reason he is always making it is because he is the town crier to every Indian garden, and tells all the news to everybody who cares to listen. As Rikki-Tikki went up the path, he heard his attention notes like a tiny dinner gong, and then the steady ding-dong-tock. "Nag is dead, dong. Nagaina is dead, ding-dong-tock." That set all the birds in the garden singing, and the frogs croaking, for Nag and Nagaina used to eat frogs as well as little birds. When Rikki got to the house, Teddy and Teddy's mother, she looked very white still, for she had been fainting, and Teddy's father came out and almost cried over him, and that night he ate all that was given him till he could eat no more, and went to bed on Teddy's shoulder, where Teddy's mother saw him when she came to look late that night. "He saved our lives, and Teddy's life," she said to her husband. "Just think, he saved all our lives." Rikki-Tikki woke up with a jump, for the mongooses are light sleepers. "Oh, it's you," he said. "What are you bothering for? All the cobras are dead, and if they weren't, I'm here." Rikki-Tikki had a right to be proud of himself, but he did not grow too proud, and he kept that garden as a mongoose should keep it, with tooth and jump and spring and bite, till never a cobra dared show its head inside the walls. End of section 14. End of Rikki-Tikki-Tavi. Tavi. Tavi.